Live from Las Vegas, it's theCUBE. Covering EMC World 2016. Brought to you by EMC. Now, here are your hosts, John Furrier and Dave Vellante.
Okay, welcome back everyone. We are here live in Las Vegas for EMC World 2016. This is SiliconANGLE's theCUBE, our flagship program where we go out to the events and extract the signal from the noise. I'm John Furrier, my co-host Dave Vellante. We've been here 7 years of EMC. We're all kicked off when theCUBE started. Always great to have great guests. CTO Stephen Manley is the CTO of Core Technologies Group of EMC, one of the main pillars of EMC strategy. Core Technologies is emerging. Core is holding down the fort, keeping the lights on. That's the legacy business. That's the big business.
Wow, you just call me the legacy business?
No, this is legacy business.
He meant bread and butter.
Yeah, there we go.
Bread and butter, the sweet spot. There, no one's moving those workloads. I mean, that's going to be stable business. That's the core machine.
Yeah, just make sure, you know, we're still innovating. We're still doing things. People still like us.
So it's clear that it's not just old technologies. Right. You saw from the keynotes, you got flash all on there. A lot of optimized workloads, certainly on the storage side. Update us, is this a change? Is this new? Did something happen? Was this part of the plan all along?
So it really is part of the plan. And you know, one of the things I think Guy covered in the keynote, which, you know, to be fair, I didn't see because I was doing customer meetings, but I'm going to assume what he said. He talks, I think, generally about sort of the technical debt environments. He talks about some of the converged software-defined environments and the cloud environments and which apps you run where. If you look at a lot of what we're trying to do in those tech debt environments, things like the all-flash VMAX, things like Unity, that really is all around how do you simplify those environments down? Because there is so much technical debt people have to pay off. And so we've had a lot of focus over the last couple of years of how do we enable them to pay that off inexpensively, right? Because there's one thing to say, I need to reduce my technical debt. But if you go to a customer and say, I can help you reduce your technical debt if you just rip everything out and start over again, they look at you like, yeah, that doesn't reduce my debt, right? So a lot of what we've been trying to do is how do we incrementally help them reduce that debt? At the same time, you know, we talked about, I think you probably talked about the copy data management work and, you know, talked some about where that's going. And that moves you into some of that new world, that converged world where, you know, Chad obviously does a lot around convergence of production workloads, but the convergence of protection is just as important in those environments. And so I think it's a good mix of helping pay down technical debt as well as getting into some of the new workloads and then connecting up into cloud.
So some of the announcements this week are build on the things that you and I have talked about for years. The whole notion of data protection and evolving that and being able to understand, you know, the metadata, leveraging the metadata, your whole copy data management thing. Right. So talk about how that's evolved and how you brought your roadmap to fruition.
Right, so a lot of this comes down to, at some point you need to focus on, you know, what is it that people are looking for in these new environments? And there were always kind of two forcing functions that we had. The first was, you had a lot of end users, or at least application owners, VM owners, who said, I need a more active role in the data protection scheme because I don't like filing tickets and waiting for things to happen in terms of recovering from outages or being able to spin up copies for test and development. And then the second was, in the technology data path, you know, VMware and applications and the storage itself started to really provide technologies that enabled faster copy creation, faster data protection. And so we've been looking at that and saying, as these trends come together, we're going to need something that really helps facilitate those workloads and facilitates those workflows. And that's going to be different than the way we used to do data protection. Because if you think about the way I used to do data protection, there was a monolithic application that I deployed, and there were a set of people whose job was to babysit and care and feed that application. You look at these copy data management workflows, and it's really all around, give me APIs that allow me to trigger this through my vRealize APIs, or through Oracle RMAN, or through Viper. And so that's really been a lot of how we've gotten that built, is we've come to understand that there are new users and new workflows, and again, that convergence that drives you to bring these things together.
You guys were joking earlier about legacy, right?
Yeah.
But you have a long legacy in data protection.
Yeah.
How are you leveraging that to your advantage in the marketplace?
I think there's a couple. You know, one is, and we had met a number of customers today who said, I'm getting a lot of talk from startups X, Y, and Z, and they're saying that they can come in and they solve my problems. Now, they solve my problems as long as my environment looks exactly like this. If everything's virtualized and I only want to do this, and they look at you and they say, but realistically, we've got everything from mainframe to I've got 20 terabyte databases on physical infrastructure to a thriving virtual environment to now a more of a cloud environment. And one of the things they're looking for is what they've come to expect from backup vendors historically is when I say, can you protect this? The answer comes back, yes. And so they're looking for somebody that says, can you cover me through my entire environment? Now, I'm not looking for, you know, least common denominator, right? When we get to the virtual environment, I expect you to be able to do new and exciting things, but I don't want you to be a one-trick pony either. And so that's one area that I think the breadth of the portfolio helps us, is that we can cover the whole environment. I think the second one is, you know, in terms of the tried and true technology, you know, people look at something like a data domain, people look at something like a recover point, they look at SRDF and they say, these are things I bet my business is on for the last decade or two decades. It's not just, you know, something I'm going to throw in and hope it works, because these are my crown jewels. And then I think the third is the expertise with applications. Because in the end, all of this infrastructure is out there to serve an application. And if you come in and say, well, I can create a snapshot, I can create something that's crash consistent, they look at you and they say, that's great, but I have an SAP environment. Simply saying, well, yeah, hopefully it'll just all come back up, that's not good enough for me. So I think those are the three.
We always talk about the data explosion. We've been talking about that for decades. My question relates to people's understanding of the value of data. We're working with our CXOs right now, and one of the premises that we're putting forth is the lack of understanding of data value is making it really hard for people to properly secure and protect right. their data. Do you see that? Do you buy that premise? And how are you helping customers solve that problem?
I do. I think what we're seeing in the environments right now is there's kind of a bifurcated approach. So there's still, I'd say, of the customers I meet, 80% of them are doing what I'd call brute force, right? And that's, they're just trying to apply policies to everything and just work harder. And we see this with some of the ransomware. All right, I'm going to do, you know, sort of an air gap kind of service for all of my protected data because I don't know what's where, and so I need to be protected for all of it. My archive solution is I'm going to index my entire backups after I put them onto object storage because, again, I don't know what I need to hold for 7 years, 10 years, whatever it is. And certainly I get it, right? Because if you can't connect with your lines of business, if you aren't getting response from the legal team, brute force is the best you've got. But over the last few years, we have seen people shift. You know, I'd say it's a 20%. 3 years ago, it was maybe 10% that were able to take these policies and say, no, we're going to get smarter about understanding our apps, understanding our data, and make more informed decisions about them. And I think a lot of what's helping them make those decisions are technologies, one of the ones that's in our portfolio is the DP search technology, where it really helps them look across their data sets and understand what's there so they can make more informed calls. Because you look out and you say, I've got an exabyte of data. Where do I start, right? So if you don't have something that helps you classify it to begin with, it seems like an impossible job and you fall back to brute force. So the trend is starting to move towards, you know, getting more insightful on your data, but there's a lot of people that have a long way to go.
But the stopgap is brute force. You mentioned air gapping is a huge boon for you guys because that creates new opportunities right now on more product sales, but ultimately there's real value for the customer there.
Oh, absolutely. I'm a big fan of the air gap. I think, you know.
Explain air gap to folks.
Oh, absolutely.
Because this is a really interesting new dynamic.
So this is something that's come about, and ransomware has been the latest trigger. Rogue admins was a trigger before, where basically customers look and they say, you know, if something gets into my environment and effectively, you know, locks all my data away from me or destroys my data for me, usually they target the backups first and then they go after the primary data so that if your primary data gets locked down, you know, the ransomware person calls you up and says, to get your data back, you're going to have to pay X amount. By the way, I've already nuked all your backups, so guess what? It's either me or you're losing all your data. That really informs them quickly how important their data is. but they're looking at that and they're saying, well, how do I secure myself? And so this notion of an air gap where, in our world, let's say you've got a data domain, you could replicate to a third data domain that's off the grid almost all the time so that it's inaccessible to these attacks, comes on the grid just briefly every day at random points of time so that I can get a copy out there. That gives them that insulation so that when the ransomware calls up, they say, no, we're fine, we've got copies back here, so we're not going to pay, you know, we're not going to pay the ransom.
So the old way was rogue admin.
Yeah.
Now the new threat is ransomware, where they basically hack you and then hold your critical infrastructure at hostage.
Yeah.
And people are just saying it's too critical, and they write big fat checks.
Right.
To get it back.
From what we've seen, it's over $1 billion business at this point.
Really?
In terms of what, yeah. That was the latest report I saw. Over $1 billion are being generated by these ransomware crooks.
Wow. How often do you hear about this? I'm texting our writers right now, because I think this is a huge phenomenon going on.
Oh, it was amazing.
Air gap is a huge tactic.
I was in New York 2 weeks ago. Every single customer I met, whether it was financial, healthcare, insurance, pharmaceutical, media and entertainment, across the board, half the time we said, oh, so what are you doing about ransomware? The other half, the very first thing they brought up in the meeting is, my boss, my team is worried about ransomware. What do you guys have to offer?
Because the consequences to them are so great that even if they had a full-on response, the downtime gap between not negotiating with hostages, or guns for hostages, whatever you want to call it. So the problem has huge consequences.
Oh, huge.
So they have to just pay the money. And the ransom guys, they know the numbers.
Oh, yeah.
So they'll say,
Yeah, exactly.
Your choice is pay me or see you fired and out of business.
Yeah, and the amazing thing is, you know, what I heard from one of the customers that got hit by this, at least in, you know, their name, you know, we'll hold their name, you know, reserved, they said, these guys are so well set up at this point that when they called for the ransom, they said, you're going to pay us in Bitcoin so it's not traceable. And since you guys probably aren't comfortable using Bitcoins, we have a help desk you can call that will help you figure out how to pay us. You look at that kind of organization.
It's an onboarding process for the ransomware. We have a self-service portal. Come in and we'll walk you right through the...
Phenomenal. And so I think it's a really important thing for people to look at, because, again, not only is your business held hostage, but, again, if it gets into the news, it's incredibly embarrassing and threatening, right? You're a financial institution. You're admitting that you got hacked, which means that, sure, your data got locked away from you and
just
you paid.
Lost sales. There's so many hidden... down benefit cost problems that they would get correct.
So the solution you have is essentially to get off the grid.
Exactly.
And come on periodically at random times so nobody can predict when that is. Do you also work with your services organization to provide sort of guidance to people as to how to set this up and best practice?
Absolutely, and in fact, part of what the smarter companies are doing in this is, again, they're doing that first initial, all right, let's get everything air-gapped. But then they're working with us and services partners to say, and then let's actually do a threat assessment of what data are we most worried about, which finally gets to that data assessment that you always want so that you can be even smarter about, again, how you prioritize your data, how you manage your service levels. So in some ways, there are some people who are, you know, to use the old Rahm Emanuel line, don't waste a good crisis, right? So I'm using this to solve the immediate problem, but now that I have my business's attention as the IT team, I'm actually using it to set ourselves up for the future to be able to better manage our environment.
Have you also seen, and I know we got to go, but have you also seen more awareness at the board level of how to respond, you know, from a communication standpoint to the inevitable penetration?
I think so. I think that's, and that's one of the reasons we're getting so much attention on this versus your sort of standard data outage. Is a standard data outage is something that, again, the more senior, non-technical people in an organization look at and they go, I guess this stuff happens, I've been used to it. Ransomware is something they see in the news. It's something that they instinctively, it's something you can instinctively
understand.
They know
the Sony hack was huge, right?
Right.
So that is absolute ransomware poster child.
Yes.
I don't want to be Sony.
Exactly.
And so
it's got the executive's attention in a way that a traditional IT problem doesn't. And so like I said, this is a chance if you're in IT to really, again, it's a bad thing, but can you use it to then, you know, basically set yourself up to make the world better in the future? The answer is, again, a lot of people are.
Well, we'd love to pay you in Bitcoin and hold you hostage here in theCUBE. Stephen, thanks so much for sharing your insight here. Great stuff. ransomware, beware, but a lot of great stuff. This is what it's all about, and we didn't even get to capacity optimization, which is a big part of the product. A lot of slew of announcements. Congratulations. We're going to circle back with Guy, who was just on earlier, but great stuff. Congratulations.
Awesome. Well, thank you, guys.
We're here at EMC World 2016, theCUBE. I'm John Furrier, Dave Vellante. You're watching theCUBE. Looking back at the history of Dell, personal